Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome back to this third day of the virtual training on the SDG 241. Yes, the first day we have seen some theoretical aspect with Spanjar on the SDG 241 methodology and the framework and the background. And then yesterday we have started with Gianluigi to see the practical calculation of the sub-indicators with the Stata tool. Your pilot data you have collected in Bangladesh. We have seen the economic dimension with the three sub-indicators, and we have started with the environmental dimension with three out of the five sub-indicators. So the plan, the agenda for today is finishing the environmental dimension with the last two sub-indicators, and then moving forward to the last dimension with the social one with the last three sub-indicators. Then I will present today the FAO or data collection questionnaire, which is the tool which FAO collects data from countries regarding, of course, the SDG indicators 241. So before starting, let me just remind you that you are all panelists and you can unmute yourself alone. So I just ask if you want to take the floor to please raise the hand first and then wait that me or Gianluigi or Spandiaro or Anirur give you the floor. So please do not start talking alone, because if not, we can have some cross people talking simultaneously, and it's not easy to follow the discussion. I have sent half an hour ago, more or less, maybe more, a little bit more, all the final presentations, so including the ones that Gianluigi will present today, which were the last missing. But as a reminder, I will send at the end of the fourth day everything all in one package. So I will send you an email with some summary, with the other also relevant documents, with the links to the page. So everything that we have mentioned during the training, I will share again after the end of tomorrow. So do not worry. As another reminder, I will also be sending certificates, because some colleagues already asked me. So do not worry also about this. And I will share also the recording. So everything will be shared with you again. Let me now ask Aspandiar if he wants to say something. If not, I will pass the floor to Gianluigi.
So thank you very much, Stefania, and good day to everyone. As Stefania summarized yesterday's proceedings and as to what we are going to cover today, let me urge you again that if you have any question at whatever slide of the presentation or regarding the status script, please do stop us and seek clarity. Because the basic aim behind us having this training is to remove all the doubts that you may be having in your mind about the data collection and analysis of respective elements of indicators. So please, feel free to stop us, and we will appreciate if this training is conducted in a more interactive way, so that, because the basic goal is for us to engage you and clarify your doubts. So with this, I immediately give the floor to Gianluigi for him to proceed.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me okay?
Good morning. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, Gianluigi.
Try to make it a bit louder. No, the voice is not that much loud.
or you want to try again, Gianluigi, to speak? Let's see if it's better. Okay, so Gianluigi just said that he will disconnect and then we'll connect again because he had apparently some audio issues. So please let's wait a few seconds. So I see
Good morning, everybody.
Perfect, Gianluigi. We hear you well now.
Okay, perfect. Because I was speaking, but I wasn't sure whether you could hear me or not. So yeah, apologize for this. Good morning, everybody again, and great to be here. I'm gonna start sharing my screen, and then we will. We will focus on the last two indicators related to the environmental dimension before moving with the last three indicators related to the social dimension. So what we have analyzed, what we analyzed yesterday were basically the first six indicators, three of which are related to the economic dimension and three of which are related to the environmental dimension. We still have to analyze two indicators related to the environmental dimension, which basically are the management of pesticide and the use of agrobiodiversity supportive practices. With the first, just to anticipate that, there are, I'm trying to be, let's say, as clear as possible, but at the same time, in order to have enough time to explain everything, including the final dashboard approach and reporting, I will try to focus more on the indicators that are more complex, and specifically these are the use of agrobiodiversity supportive practices and the FIA, the food insecurity experience scale. And these are gonna take a little bit more time than the others indicator, which is the reason why I want to focus more on these. But of course, as Asfandiar said before, please feel free to stop me anytime you wish. So concerning the management of pesticide, the idea behind this sub-indicator is pretty much the same as the analysis of the management of fertilizer, but there are a few adjustments, of course. And the idea is to characterize the agricultural, the sustainability status of agricultural area associated with a given holding according to the information that we have of the whether or not the holding uses pesticide and whether or not there is awareness by the farmer of the risk associated with the use of pesticide, both related to the environmental, let's say the environmental risk and related to the health of the person who uses pesticides. Therefore, we will characterize the sustainability status as desirable in cases where the farm uses only moderately or slightly hazardous pesticide. I have added a link which will direct you to the World Health Organization website and where you have the list of all moderately or slightly hazardous pesticide. In addition to that, we will also we characterize as desirable those who use moderately or slightly hazardous pesticide. But it is important to know whether the agricultural holding adopt health-related measure, which must be all three health-related measure, and at least four of the environmental-related measure that I will explain in a second. Concerning the, let's say, characterization of the agricultural area as acceptable, we will use as a criteria for this characterization the information related to the use of a moderately or slightly hazardous pesticide and whether at the same time the agricultural holding takes some measure to mitigate both environmental and health related risk, which must be at least two from each of the list that I will show you in a second. And finally, unsustainable agricultural area are those where the holding uses highly or extremely hazardous pesticide. And again, here you have the list from the World Health Organization report, or uses moderately or slightly hazardous pesticide, but without taking any specific measure that can mitigate both environmental and health related risk associated with their use, which must be less than two. So basically, just to summarize again, green in case at least four health-related measures, three health-related measures are adopted and four related environmental measures are adopted. If only two from the two lists are adopted, the agricultural area is gonna be acceptable. And finally, if less than two, and if there is also use of highly or extremely hazardous pesticide, then the agricultural area is gonna be unsustainable. Where do we find the information that we need? Of course, we need information on whether or not the agricultural holding is using a pesticide and the type of pesticide that they are using. And here is the information which you can easily trace back in question B10 and B11, which specifically ask about whether pesticide for crop and livestock production are used by the agricultural holding, and then the type of pesticide that the agricultural holding used in case there is an affirmative answer to question B10. Then we need to know about awareness of the environmental and health related risk. And if there is awareness, whether they take any specific measure. Now, there is, of course, a screening question asking whether the agricultural holding takes specific measures to protect people from health-related risk. If yes, and if the agricultural holding adopts specific measures to avoid environmental-related risk. And, of course, the list of measures adopted. So these are the three measures that are ideally adopted by the holding in case of uses of pesticide, which is adherence to label direction for pesticide use, maintenance and cleaning of protection equipment after use, and safe disposal of waste. And and similarly, we have a long list of measures that apply to the environment. We have a total of 12 measures that have been included in the list. I'm not gonna list all of them for reason of time, but you can easily take a look at the later stage. So these are the information that we need. And of course, given the information, given that now we are aware about the criteria that should be used for the characterization of the sustainability status of the holding, we need to construct our primary variable. In the end, what we need are six primary variables, three of which are instrumental for the calculation of the indicator. So the first primary variable is, of course, about the use of pesticides. So we're gonna basically generate a variable, which is a dummy, and which takes value one if the agricultural use pesticide. Then we wanna know the type of pesticide. So we're gonna construct a variable which takes value one if the agricultural holding used moderately or slightly hazardous pesticide, and zero otherwise, where otherwise implies using extremely hazardous or illegal pesticides. Finally, we're gonna construct whether the agricultural holding adopt health-related measure, which are the three we saw before, and therefore we're gonna have the total number of health-related measure. In addition to that, we need to construct additional 12 dummy variable. Each dummy variable is gonna take value one if that specific environmental measure has been adopted by the agricultural holding. And finally, and this is the other key variable which I put in bold here, the total number of environmental measure adopted. So we have a variable which is a categorical variable going from 0 to 12, depending on how many environmental measures are adopted. Okay, and this is how the, let's say, this is a portion of the data set again, and this is how the data set would look like once we have constructed the variable that I just mentioned. For example, in case of the agricultural holding number two, you will see that the agricultural area associated is acceptable. And the reason why is basically the adoption of moderately or slightly hazardous pesticide, but the number of environmental and health related measure, my apologies, there is a typo here, is only two for each of these two categories of measures. And indeed, if we go back very quickly to the criteria, you will see that the farm uses only moderately or slightly hazardous pesticide and takes some measure which must be at least two from the list. And this is reflected in the agricultural holding number two. Then we have a number of non-sustainable agricultural area associated with six agricultural holding. There are different reasons why these are non-sustainable. In the first case is because of the use of highly and extremely hazardous and illegal pesticide, and in addition to that, none of the measures both related to the environment and to the health of the person have been adopted. In another instance, we have that the agricultural holding in reality uses moderately or slightly hazardous pesticide, so which is a better condition as compared to the previous, but the number of measures adopted is relatively low, and however lower than what we would like to adopt, the number that we would like to adopt. And finally, the last case is where the agricultural area is sustainable or is desirable because of the use of moderately or slightly hazardous pesticide. But you can see here that the number of health-related measures is three, which is in line with our main criteria, whereas the number of environmental measures is four. So we must adopt at least four measures for related to the environment in order to be sustainable, and three related to the health. Now I'm going to the,
Gianluigi, yeah. just 1 second. Can you just go back to the previous slide?
Sure. This one, you mean?
Yes,
this one. So there has been a slight revision of the measures that are recommended to agriculture holdings if they are using, you know, pesticides. So these measures have been slightly revised. So as per the latest version of the methodological note, as well as the survey questionnaire, these have been slightly, you know, refined. Let me put it that way. I just wanted to highlight this point because, you know, some of the measures that are shown here are no longer part of the methodological note.
Maybe if I can add something, tomorrow we will be sending also the guidelines for data analysis, and you can see in detail exactly this list revised. So the final version of this list is in that document.
Okay, and perhaps if I can add, and this is something that I should have said before, what I would like to stress is that the data collection the pilot data collection in Bangladesh was conducted before the revision, which is the reason why, as Asfandiar and Stefania have just mentioned, we might have slightly differences between the scripts. So what I can do is to, as long as there will be a new data collection, a new pilot or a new data collection exercise in a given country, we can adapt these scripts according to the revised version of the questionnaire. This is just to highlight, but I guess that it is also important to know that how to construct the variables, and of course, as I was saying yesterday, to really pay attention about the variable to be included in a given indicator based on the latest version of the methodology and survey module. I'm going to the calculation of this indicator, which is indicator number 7, which is not this one. Yeah. Okay. And again, here we summarize before starting, just as a reminder, the criteria we need to calculate, we need to implement. And secondly, we are going to upload the section of the survey with data about use of pesticides. So you will see that the first thing that I'm gonna do is to, as I was explaining before, I'm gonna compute a dummy variable, a number of dummy variables in reality, which takes value 1 if that specific environmental measure has been adopted. So what I do, for example, if I'm gonna search for this variable, you can see here, this variable is related to a given environmental measure, which is a just planting time for breaking the pest cycle. And in case the answer is yes, I'm gonna construct a dummy which takes value 1. Otherwise, it's gonna be 0. So I'm gonna run this loop. And finally, I'm gonna construct a variable, which is basically a categorical variable going from 0 to 12, depending on how many environmental related measures have been adopted by the holding, the agricultural holding. So we no longer need the dummy, because what we're really interested in is the number of environmental measures adopted, which I'm gonna tabulate right now. I'm sorry, here we are. And you see that like there are approximately 61% of total agricultural holding here, or 258 in absolute number that do not adopt any measure. And then we have 4% adopting one measure, and so on and so forth. Of course, we still don't know whether among all agricultural holding that do not adopt any measure, they use or not pesticide, and especially we don't know the type of pesticide which is used. That's why we need to cross-tab this variable with the variable capturing whether or not the pesticides are used and the type of pesticide. I'm going to do the same now for in order to get the total number of health-related measures. So what I'm going to do is to perform is to run a loop, and I'm going to construct accordingly three dummy variables, taking value one if that specific health-related measure has been adopted by the holding, and zero otherwise. And finally, as I did before, I'm going to construct a variable which basically is going to tell me the number of health-related measures adopted by the agricultural holding. Again, I'm going to drop the dummy as I no longer need it. What I'm really interested in is the number of health and environmental measures adopted. And again, just to make sure everything is okay, I'm going to tabulate the number of health-related measures adopted. You will see that here there is a more or less uniform distribution with 27% of total agricultural holding adopting non-health-related measures. Then we have 23.1% of total agricultural holding adopting all of the three health-related measures. Now, again, let me highlight the fact that here the reason why health-related measures have not been adopted is still unknown. I mean, we don't know whether they use or not pesticide, and especially we don't know the type of pesticide, which is, that's why we need to cross-tab this variable on, about the number of environmental measures with the variable informing about the use and type of pesticides used by the holding. Last step that I need to know is to construct the final sub-indicator. The final sub-indicator to characterize the sustainability status of agricultural area of the holdings. So what I'm gonna do, in case no pesticide is used, I'm gonna characterize the corresponding agricultural area of the holding as sustainable by default. So what I'm gonna do is to say, generate the seventh sub-indicator about sustainability if the agricultural holding does not use any pesticide, which is this variable B10,000. In case, and you see here how the code has changed from 2 to 1, where 1 implies that there has been use of pesticide, but the pesticide used are moderately or only slightly hazardous pesticide. Let me cross-tab this variable just for you to get a better sense of what I'm doing. You see, this is a variable which basically takes value 0 if pesticides are not used, value 1 if only moderately or slightly hazardous pesticides are used, and 2 if highly or extremely hazardous or illegal pesticide are used, which is the vast majority of agricultural holding. Apparently they use moderately or slightly hazardous pesticide. But again, in case
illegal,
of
what does illegal pesticides,
sorry,
what does mean of illegal pesticides?
Well, I guess, okay, I'm not an expert on pesticide, and I don't know if Aspandiaro Stefania want to elaborate more, but illegal pesticide, I assume this is something that is forbidden by the law. So this is something that I guess is purchased on the black market. That's my assumption. This is something that
at this point, may I, you know, request Saleha, because Saleha conducted this pilot. Can she clarify that what was meant, or during the survey, what she meant, you know, explained to the, you know, interviewee about this question?
Okay.
And then Aspandiaro can sum up.
Okay, about the use of illegal or highly extremely hazardous pesticide, and this is why it is important to make reference to the enumerator manual, because there we cited the World Health Organization report, where there is a clear long list of all legal and illegal pesticides, including those that are extremely hazardous or slightly hazardous. So of course, I'm not an expert on pesticide, and I couldn't say specifically what are the pesticides that are illegal, what are the pesticides that are slightly hazardous, or the pesticides that are moderately hazardous. But the reference to the World Health Organization report should help in this regard. I don't know if I answer properly your question.
Okay. Okay.
Okay. So, thank you, by the way. So moving ahead, what I'm gonna do now is to still characterize those agricultural holdings using moderately or slightly hazardous pesticide as having a sustainable agricultural area in cases the number of health-related measures is 3, so it's higher or equal to 3, but in this case we only have 3 measures, and the number of environmental measures is higher than 3. You see here, this must be higher than 3, at least 4. It implies at least 4. And again, the agricultural area is gonna be acceptable in case of use of moderately or slightly hazardous pesticide, but the number of health-related measures is only 2, and the number of environmental measures is only 2, which implies being lower than what is required for being sustainable or desirable. Finally, I'm gonna categorize agricultural area as unsustainable in case the agricultural holding uses highly hazardous pesticide, and in case of use of moderately hazardous pesticide, but the number of environmental measure and that related measure is lower than what would be expected in order to be acceptable, which must be lower than 3. Than 2, I'm sorry, for both categories of measures. I'm gonna compute the indicator. And finally, as we did yesterday, I'm gonna save my data set here. You see, for each agricultural area, for each agricultural holding, we will have the corresponding sustainability status of the agricultural area associated with that holding. Okay, I don't know if you have a further question to ask, which I'm happy to answer.
Hey, thank you, Gianluigi. Let's wait a little bit to see if anyone would like to raise a question, take the floor, make some comments. So yes, Mrs. Katun, please.
Thank you. Stefania, for giving me the floor. In Bengali, we translated the questionnaire. The questionnaire was B11 was number one option was less dangerous, and number two option was highly hazardous. So illegal was not there. The word illegal was not used. And about the less dangerous and highly dangerous, there is a list of, I think it was from World Bank. So there are very much items of pesticides. But in our cognitive test also, we have reported that in our case, our farmers, is very much difficult for them to identify which is very much dangerous or which is hazardous. So this can be refreshed, we have also suggested. So I have heard that Harvard already said that this was already replaced. Maybe the future questionnaire will be better for us. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for your clarification. There were some noises, so I didn't get the overall intervention. But yeah, thank you very much for your clarification. And about the use of pesticide and the typology of pesticide used. And this is, as you can see, I have re-shared the question concerning how this question is how this information is captured through the survey module. Now, I must admit that data collection in Bangladesh was performed a couple of years ago, and therefore I cannot really remember the exact question and how it was asked, but and I would ask confirmation from Ascondiara and Stefania, but I guess that there were no revision between data collection and the latest version of the questionnaire. That's my understanding, and that's my, therefore there should be, I mean, the data collected about the use of pesticide and the typologies of pesticide should be absolutely in line with the latest version of the survey module. Okay, unless there are any other input, I would suggest we go ahead for reason of time. And we move to the eighth biodiversity supportive, to the eighth sub-indicator, which speaks about the use of agrobiodiversity supportive practices. Okay, this is one of the, this is a super interesting indicator, though not easy to calculate, because of course it requires a very large number of information. And before starting introducing this indicator, there were few revisions, especially if compared to the data collection activities that were done through the pilot survey in Bangladesh two years ago. So the revisions were, of course, done because of expert consultation. Experts are suggested to slightly revise, and these revisions were included. The data I have about these indicators specifically and the calculation of the indicator is related to the previous, I mean, the previous version as compared to the one that I'm showing in this slide. However, therefore, before we had a total of 7 biodiversity supportive practices that were further reduced to 6. And there were few revision about biodiversity supportive practices, very few, I mean. So that's why you will notice that the calculation of this indicator is not perfectly in line with the latest version of the questionnaire. But still, I mean, here what is important to know is how to calculate the indicator. And then again, pay attention about the information that you need to include in your specific indicator. Okay, moving ahead, this indicator wants to measure the proportion of agricultural area according to the level of adoption of biodiversity friendly practices. And a total of 6 biodiversity supportive practices have been identified through expert consultation, which are the ones listed in this slide. And these are related to at least 10% of the holding area must be left for natural or diverse vegetation. The farm produces agricultural products that are organically certified, or the products are undergoing the certification process. The farm does not use medically important antimicrobials as a growth promoter, and at least of the two following crops must contribute to the farm production. Among the crops, there are temporary pasture, aquaculture, livestock, or animal products, freeze on farm, and finally permanent crops. And then the farm practices, the agricultural holding practices crop or crop pasture rotation, which involves at least two crops or crops pasture on 80% of the farm cultivated area. Finally, in case of agricultural holding engaging in livestock production, at least some livestock must be locally adopted, of locally adopted breeds. Okay, now the sustainability criteria that have been thought in order to derive this indicator are at least two out of the five for countries that do not have organic certification, and three out of six for countries with organic certification, in which case, in case the agricultural holding meets two out of five or three out of six of the above mentioned biodiversity supportive practice, the agricultural area will be sustainable. In case only one out of five, again, for countries with no organic certification, or two out of six for countries with organic certification are met by agricultural holding, then the sustainability status is going to be acceptable. And finally, if less than two of the above biodiversity supportive practices are met by the agricultural holding, the agricultural area will be red, unsustainable. Okay, where do we find the information we need? We need to know concerning the first biodiversity supportive practices, we need to know if at least 10% of the holding area is left for natural or diverse vegetation. And these must include, of course, natural pasture and grassland, maintaining wildflower strips, stone and wood heaps, and so on and so forth. The information can be easily found in question B17 and B18, where basically it is there is a screening question asking whether the holding area is covered by natural or diverse vegetation and which one. So answer from, among the list of potential answer from 1 to 5, you have natural pasture and so on and so forth. And then if the respondent reports that the area is covered by natural and diverse vegetation, you're gonna further ask what is the total area covered, because what we are interested in is to know that at least 80% is covered by natural or diverse vegetation. Therefore, information on B18 must be combined with the information about total area of the agricultural holding in order to derive the corresponding share. Then we want to know whether the farm produces agricultural products that are organically certified, or whether the products are undergoing the certification process. This is asked in question B21 and B22, which basically ask whether the agricultural holding produce crop or livestock that are certified. And if the answer is positive, we wanna know the registration number and the certifying body. What is the institution that has certified organic process of production? And finally, we wanna know whether, that's not finally, really. We want to know whether the farmer use or do not use or does not use medically important antimicrobials as a growth promoter. So you will have the question asked in B19, and you will have yes, no, or I don't know. At least the fourth biodiversity supported practice is about which kind of production, which kind of crop or livestock or aquaculture contribute to the total production of the agricultural holding. So we want to make sure that in order to meet the criteria needed for the construction of this indicator, we want to know whether the agricultural holding contribute to the total production by temporary crops, pasture, permanent crops, tree on farm, etc. This information again is asked in section 2 of the survey model, where we are going to inquire about all the crops and the corresponding area of the agricultural holding, including the farm gate price. So this is an information that is widely used throughout all the indicators that we have for 2.4.1. The fifth biodiversity supportive practice wants to know if at least the agricultural holding practice crops on 80 or pasture rotation that involves at least two crops on at least 80% of the farm area cultivated. And the question is very straightforward. We want to know what is the percentage of the agricultural area on which crop rotation or crop pasture rotation that involve at least two crops is practiced. And then you report directly the percentage. So this is the fifth biodiversity. Let me correct this one. This is a typo, but this is the fifth biodiversity, and this is the sixth. This is due to the fact that I changed its slide. And finally, the sixth biodiversity supportive practice wants to know whether livestock includes locally adopted breeds. And this is capturing question A4, where we ask for each species of animal. Maximum, we're going to ask for three species that arise on the agricultural holding. We need to list the different breeds and the number of animals they represent. Of course, this question must be complemented with country-specific information about locally adopted breeds. And I recall we had a discussion with BBS in the past in order to identify what are the locally adopted breeds, and in order, therefore, to derive this sixth biodiversity supportive practice. Okay, in terms of the construction of this indicator, what we are gonna do is basically to construct six biodiversity dummy variable. Each variable is gonna take value one in case that specific biodiversity supportive practice is adopted by the agricultural holding and zero otherwise. And finally, what we have to do is to count how many of these biodiversity supportive practices have been adopted by the agricultural holding. And we will derive the corresponding sustainability status of the agricultural area of the holding based on how many biodiversity supportive practices have been adopted. Now, again, I'm going to back to the indicator, which I have slightly revised to the extent possible in order to harmonize with the latest version of the survey questionnaire. But I need to tell you that not all of the biodiversity supportive practices can be constructed. So I'm gonna only focus on those that are aligned between data collection process in Bangladesh 2 years ago and the survey, the latest survey model. So where we have a correspondence between the information collected and the latest version of the survey. Okay, as usual, let's first upload the data set that we need. And the first biodiversity criteria, biodiversity practice, speak about. I'm gonna work now in parallel with the slide because we know that the indicators are not fully aligned. So leave at least 10% of the holding area for natural or diverse vegetation. So this is the first biodiversity criteria. What I'm gonna do is to calculate the total agricultural area. I convert in hectares as usual, and then I'm gonna calculate the total agricultural area which is left to natural or diverse vegetation. And again, everything must be converted in hectares in order to make the data harmonized, the two variables harmonized. And finally, I'm gonna calculate the percentage of the area which is left to natural or diverse vegetation. And finally, I'm gonna construct the first dummy variable, which is equal to one in cases the total area which is left to natural or diverse vegetation is greater than one. Okay, there are the second criterion is in reality, the second biodiversity supporting practice is no longer in the latest, is no longer in the new and latest methodology. Therefore, I'm not gonna calculate this one, but I move ahead with the calculation of those crop tree or tree products, livestock or animal product or aquaculture that contribute to the overall agricultural production. In this case, again, the ultimate objective is to have a dummy variable taking a value one if that specific biodiversity supportive practice is implemented, in which case means that any of the above listed crop or livestock or aquaculture production contribute to the total production of the whole. What I'm gonna do is to specifically investigate about all the crop. You can see here all the crop that are cultivated, harvested by the agricultural holding. The same applies to livestock and to fishery and to aquaculture in reality or other on-farm products. And finally, I'm gonna see if at least two of those contribute to the agricultural production of the holding. In case of affirmative responses, we're gonna calculate a dummy which is equal to one. Otherwise, the dummy is gonna be equal to zero. So the logic is exactly the same as before. So you see, I calculate the third. I say underscore. I put underscore three. Biodiversity supportive practice, if any of those contribute to the total production, or any of those crop, livestock, or aquaculture production contribute to the total production of the holding. I'm gonna run everything all together because I'm gonna save a temporary data set. And I'm gonna finally merge this one with the other biodiversity supportive practice that I calculated before. So basically, if you go here, these are our so far three dummy variables. Each dummy variable takes value zero or one, depending on whether the specific biodiversity supportive practice has been adopted. I move ahead with the third, which is the fourth, which is at least 80% of the farm area, rotation involved at least two crops, because this has changed, as you can see here. Here it is. Practice crop or crop passive rotation on at least two crops or crops a pasture for 80% of the total farm cultivated area. So the question is straightforward. And so what we're going to do is to say, in case 80% based on the answer given to, let me show to better clarify, to this question here. I'm sorry, I need to find the question. Here it is, you see? If a question B20, the reported percentage of agricultural area on which crop rotation involving at least two crops is greater than 80%, in that case, I'm gonna construct a dummy variable which is equal to one. Otherwise, the corresponding biodiversity supportive practice is equal to zero, meaning that this is not implemented. I'm gonna construct this biodiversity criteria. Okay, here there is one more biodiversity criteria which is no longer included in the new revision of the methodology. And again, this will be only implemented where new data will be collected. And indeed I added no longer considered. So I move ahead with the, okay, where we are right now, I got lost meanwhile. Okay, this has been covered. We need to know whether the farm use medically important antimicrobials as a growth promoter. This has been covered and this has not been covered. So what we still need to know is this one, which I'm gonna highlight, and this one, which I'm gonna highlight. Concerning the use of antimicrobials as a growth promoter, okay. Let me show you, where is it? This is natural vegetation. I'm getting there. Okay, let's go with the seventh, which in reality is the sixth biodiversity supportive practice, which is about livestock with locally adopted breeds. So again, there was a consultation, I recall, about identification of locally adopted breeds. And the calculation of this variable is basically for each animal species, we want to know if there are locally adopted breeds. And the maximum number of animal species is three. So that are asked in the survey. So this is the first animal species, this is the second animal species, and these are the questions that are asked, which again, I'm gonna show here, because it's important to know where this information has been taken. Here it is. This is the information that we need, where we basically collect data about animal species and breeds, and the number of animals that they have for each breeds and animal species. So what we want to know after we have consulted the expert that can inform us about the locally adopted animal species, if there is any of them in the that is part of the livestock of the agricultural holding. So I'm gonna compute this seventh, which in reality is the sixth biodiversity supportive practice. This is for the second animal species. What I'm doing here is simply to investigate if within this species there are locally adopted breeds. And finally, sorry, I need to rerun everything because there were some temporary data set. And finally, I need to calculate the total number of biodiversity supported practices within for each agricultural holding in order to determine, to characterize the sustainability status. So what I'm gonna do is to generate a variable which count the overall number of biodiversity supported practices, and I'm gonna tabulate, and you will see which the total number of biodiversity supported practices goes from 0 to 6, depending on how many have been implemented within the holding. And finally, I'm gonna construct the indicator. Now, again, this indicator speaks about the number of biodiversity supportive practices that have been adopted, and depending on that number, we're gonna characterize the sustainability status. I'm gonna show you the sustainability status of each household depending on how many have been adopted. In this case, for example, in the first agricultural holding, the total number is equal to 6. That's why the sustainability status is desirable. So, and again, what I would like you to pay attention is related, and I'm going back to the presentation, to the fact that the total number of biodiversity supportive practices that are met by the agricultural holding can vary from 2 to 3 out of 5 or 6, depending on whether or not the countries has organic certification or not. So for countries with no organic certification, the agricultural area is desirable if only 2 out of 5 are met. For countries with organic certification, the number of biodiversity supporting practices increases from 2 to 3, because the total number of potentially biodiversity practices is slightly higher, from 5 to 6. Okay, this was the last indicator. And now, unless you have question.
Okay, so let's see. This was a quite complicated sub-indicators, so maybe let's leave a few seconds to see if someone would like some clarifications or some doubts. Well, I think we can move on. So maybe we can Gianluigi, maybe you can go with the first sub-indicator in the social dimension, and then we break, because then we will have FIES, which is quite complicated. So we break before FIES.
Okay, perfect. Sounds great. Okay, I'll try to be as concise as possible. Now we need to look at the rationale and the computation of three main sub-indicators related to the social dimension. These are the wage rate in agriculture, the food insecurity experience scale, and secure tenure rights to land. Concerning the wage rate in agriculture, the idea is to characterize again the sustainability status of the agricultural area of a given holding, depending on whether the holding, first of all, hire a skilled agricultural worker, and then if the remuneration paid, the salary, the wage paid to these skilled agricultural workers is above, below, or equal to the minimum wage in the country and in the agriculture. Of course, there is one clarification that has to be done. Since many agricultural holdings do not hire any unskilled agricultural worker, then the default is that the agricultural area is sustainable by definition, simply because they do not pay any wage and we are not able to say whether the wage paid is higher, lower, or equal to the minimum wage in the country. In case, however, the agricultural holding hire unskilled labor and the wage paid to unskilled labor is above the minimum national wage rate or minimum agricultural sector wage rate, if available. So here we gave a couple of options. In that case, the sustainability status is gonna be desirable. If the wage rate paid to unskilled labor is equal to the minimum wage rate or to the minimum agricultural sector wage rate, if available, the sustainability status is acceptable. In case it is below, the wage rate is below, then the sustainability status is gonna be unsustainable. What do we need in order to construct this indicator? Of course, we need to know whether or not the agricultural holding hires unskilled workers. In case they say no, then their sustainability status is gonna be desirable by default. And then we want to know the daily average wage, which is paid both in kind and in cash to unskilled agricultural workers hired by the agricultural holding. In order to benchmark what is paid to unskilled agricultural worker and what would be the minimum wage or the minimum agricultural wage rate in a given country, we need, of course, to derive the information on the minimum wage at the country level. Ideally, we want to derive this information. We want this information being provided by the national statistical offices or by the national statistical office of the country of interest. But in case this is not available, the International Labour Organization has international data repository, which also include the minimum wage, which is paid at the country level. So we can easily take that minimum wage in case it's not available from the National Statistical Office, which I don't think is the case, but this is an alternative source. Now, typically, if we decide to rely on the minimum wage, which is provided by the International Labour Organization, and I have added the link here, the hyperlink here, this is typically provided in US dollar, whereas our data are collected in local currency units. So we need to convert using the official exchange rate, and the official exchange rate can be taken basically and virtually from any external repository. For example, just to name a few, we can rely on the World Bank World Development Indicators, which contain the official exchange rate from 1960 to 2019, and perhaps even 2020. We can rely on the International Monetary Fund. There are many international sources that can be used to simply convert into local currency unit the minimum wage that we need to benchmark with our wage rate paid to unskilled agricultural worker. And of course, the content of the primary variable are basically two. First of all, we want to know, we need to construct the total daily wage, which is simply constructed by adding the daily wage in cash and in kind from this question here. This is the question C2. And secondly, we want to know whether the employee, whether there are employee working on the agricultural hold, which is simply a dummy variable, which takes value 1 if there are employee and 0 otherwise. So this is a typical portion of the data set to derive the sustainability status. So you will see here that variable C01 is giving us information about any agricultural employee is hired by the agricultural holding. You will see that for the first agricultural holding, the answer is yes. Then we want to know the daily wage. Okay, here I converted in US international dollar, but just to get a better sense, it doesn't matter whether we convert in international dollar or we keep it in local currency unit. It is important to have the same unit of measurement, both for the daily wage and for the minimum wage. Then the conversion is done by applying a constant. Therefore, there are no changes whether we decide to go for international dollar, US dollar or local currency unit. These are all constant. Yes, please. Okay. The second variable is the daily wage, in which case is $12 per employee. And the third variable is the minimum wage on a daily basis, which is $8. This is the minimum wage which is paid. You will see that for the first agricultural holding, the daily wage is $12, the minimum is $8, which implies that the agricultural worker is paid more than the minimum, and that's why the sustainability status is desirable. Okay, let's take agricultural holding number 231. They hire agricultural worker, but the minimum wage paid is lower compared to the wage paid is lower than the minimum wage. So each worker gets around $7.5, but the minimum wage is $8. That's why the sustainability status associated to the agricultural area of holding number 231 is non-sustainable. Now, another case I want to focus the agricultural holding number 19, where you see that basically the holding does not hire any worker. There are no employees working on the agricultural holding, which is the reason why, by default, the sustainability status is desirable. Okay, I'm going very, very quickly to the computation of this indicator, which is indicator number one. And this is super, very easy, because we only need three information. We need the information whether the agricultural holding hire a skilled worker, yes or no. And we need information on the wage paid, which is paid in both in kind and in cash. What I'm gonna do is to generate a variable which basically adapts the daily wage in cash with the daily wage in kind. And then I'm gonna convert it in international dollar just for me to better understand the daily wage paid, but you can leave it in local currency unit. Finally, I'm gonna take the minimum wage. This is the minimum daily wage, which is measured by taking from the ILO the minimum monthly wage. Then we divided it by 20, assuming that each month a worker will more or less work 20 working days. And then in order to have the same unit of measurement as for the daily wage paid to a skilled agricultural worker, I converted in international dollar. So at the end of the story, what I'm gonna get is the daily wage and the minimum wage. The minimum wage, of course, is a constant because this applies to all workers in the country. The daily wage varies depending on how much each worker gets in exchange of the labor input given to the agricultural holding. I'm gonna compute the sustainability status, which gonna be green in case no workers are employed in the agricultural holding. Again, it's gonna be green in case the daily wage is higher than the minimum wage paid in the country. It's gonna be yellow acceptable in case there is the daily wage overlaps with the minimum wage. And finally, it's gonna be unsustainable in instances where the daily wage, you see here, the daily wage is lower than the minimum wage. Gonna compute the indicator. And I'm gonna save my data set here. You will see that here we have the sustainability status. Here we have the household identification, the holding identification number, whether or not the holding hire any skilled worker. And then we have the daily wage paid. This is the local currency unit. And this is the minimum wage again in local currency unit. We can have different unit of measurement, for example, international dollar, if we prefer it. In the end, again, what we are gonna do is to divide everything by a constant, so there are no issues in terms of the content of the final indicators. And finally, we need to save our data set, which will appear as all other data set we have developed so far. Sustainability status related to this indicator and the household identification number. Okay, I'm gonna stop sharing and answer question, if any.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Gianluigi. So this was the first sub-indicator in the social dimension. Now we only need to go through other two, but before moving to the next one, we will take a break. If you have any question concerning this one, so the wage rate in agriculture, please feel free to ask. Okay, otherwise, I mean, you have the break even to think about questions in case you have. So we can, you can ask these questions even after the break. So we will resume in 30 minutes as usual. So we come back at 3:50 p.m. Bangladesh time.
Okay.
Welcome back. Hope you had had some nice rest. So let's take again the conversation from when we left. We were we have seen all the three sub-indicators in the economic dimension. We have seen the five sub-indicators in the environmental dimension, and we have seen the first one in the social dimension. So if you have any question, please raise your hand now about these first nine sub-indicators, especially the last one on the wage rate of agriculture, in case you have one. If not, let me make Gianluigi go host again. I don't know why it was removed. Okay. So in case we don't have any question, I think Gianluigi can take the floor again, and let's see the first one, which is another articulated sub-indicator. So please try to pay attention to this sub-indicator. So as Gianluigi, you have the floor.
Okay, thank you, Stefania. Gonna share my screen again. And we still have a couple of indicators missing. One is about food insecurity experience scale, and the other one is about secured tenure rights to land. I will start by explaining the rationale behind the food insecurity experience scale, namely the FIAS indicator, which wants basically to measure the severity of food insecurity, which is experienced by a given household that is related to the holder of the holding. And this sub-indicator is basically computed according to a standardized approach, which is further revised in order to make it aligned to the calculation of the sustainability status of agricultural area. Now, the FIAS indicator, when let's say contextualized for the SDG 2.4.1, is based on three main criteria to characterize the sustainability status. In case a household of the holder of the holding, they experience a mild food insecurity. There is a mistake. I'm sorry, but okay, here we go. A mild food insecurity, then the sustainability status is gonna be desirable. In case of moderate food insecurity, the sustainability status is acceptable. And in case of severe food insecurity, the sustainability status is red or unsustainable, to better say. Now, this indicator requires a little bit of attention because its calculation is a bit different compared to all other indicators. So what we basically have to do is to follow a three-step approach. In the first step, we need to understand what are the questions that need to be taken into account for the calculation of this indicator. And the information about the food insecurity, which is experienced by a given household, are basically contained in 8 standardized FIAS questions. These are questions that applies regardless of whether we are including them in an household survey, in the specific survey module developed by FAO for SDG 2.4.1, or in any other type of survey. These are standard questions. We need to rely on them and to gather the information accordingly. So these are the 8 questions that have been included in this survey module. And each question has a reference period, which is the last 12 months prior to the date of the interview. Each question asks about a specific, let's say, experience of food insecurity. For example, if you look at question C3, it is asked whether there was a time over the past 12 months when the household was worried that there would not be enough food to eat because of lack of money. And then there are additional questions which are around these lines, which ask about whether there was a time in which the household has to run out food because of lack of money, or if the nutrients of the food were of scarce quality or poor quality, and so on and so forth. All these questions, they have a yes-no response. And in addition, of course, there is I don't know, which is not what we want to get, but it's an option as well. All these questions have been translated into 8 corresponding items. So if you look at the matrix in the table at the top of of this slide, you will see that for this question, there is a corresponding item. For example, if you were worried that there would not have been enough food to eat, then the corresponding item is going to be worried. Healthy is related to the second question, when when the respondent is asked whether there was a time the household was not able to eat healthy and nutritious food because of lack of money, and so on and so forth. These items allow, these questions allow capturing, therefore, the 8 specific items. And each item is further associated with a given degree of severity of food insecurity. You will see that if you answer yes to the first question, which is about the item which captured whether you were worried to not eat enough food, the severity of food insecurity is going to be mild, but then it increases, the severity increases depending on the question where you answer yes. If you skip a lunch, a meal, for an entire day, this item is gonna have the highest degree of severity of food insecurity. You see here that this will basically correspond in the second table at the bottom of this slide. You will see that having insufficient food quantity is gonna be associated with a severe food insecurity status of the household. And the corresponding item is world day. Now, the first step that we need to implement is to work a little bit on the reshaping of the data set. The way the data are collected basically according to the way the data are collected, we will get a sort of raw data set where we will have, you see here, that here what we have is simply the question number and then a series of code depending on whether the person said yes or not to that specific number. Now we need to work a little bit with the label and we need to prepare our data set in order to analyze the severity of food insecurity of each household. In order to do so, a key step is to recode all question, and we're gonna use all code that correspond to 2 for no answer to a given question, and the code that corresponds to 1 for yes response. This implies adding a sort of a standard labels for the 8 questions collected. And basically what we do is to transform this data set, the raw data set, into a more refined data set having both the item. You will see that you have the item corresponding to the first question and the corresponding question for each agricultural holding, household of the holder of the holding, to better say. But for simplicity, let's say agricultural holding. For example, the first agricultural holding responded yes to the first question, which is related to the item worried, and so on and so forth. This is the way the data set must be reshaped before estimating the severity of food insecurity.
Nico, may I just, you know, ask a question at this point?
Absolutely, yes.
You know, a few days back, we have conducted one training on SDG 1.1 and 1.2. Yeah. There, we also discussed the fears. And in the fears question, there were 4 options. One was yes, one was no, one was don't know, and another was don't want to reply, something like that. And in this module, do you consider the 4 type of response or only 2?
Okay, no. Of course, as you can see here, we also have the 4 options. These are fully harmonized according to the standard fears.
Then how do you manage that 3 and 4?
Yeah, but of course, I mean, if it is I don't know or I don't want to answer, these are not gonna be captured in the estimates of the probability of being food insecure. But ideally, what we aim, well, in theory, I don't know and I don't want to answer should only correspond to a very small share of the overall sample. Otherwise, there is.
I understand that. But in the Excel sheet, you are transforming the data to the peer sheet. So yeah. There is yes or no. And then if for some question there is don't know, or then should it be missing dot or something like that in the
sheet? It's gonna be missing. Because you don't know. If you don't know, or if you don't want to answer, it implies that the information is missing. You cannot invent the information. That's why you only consider one and two. Because a missing value implies that you don't really know the answer. Unless you have more information, and that's why, goes back to what we discussed yesterday. There is always, the sooner you start data entry operation, the better you have, you can more timely adjust for no responses or for potential data entry mistake. But just to, long story short, to answer your question, if you don't know, then the data, the value should be missing. You cannot say, I don't know means that simply I don't know. Therefore, I cannot say, yes, I was worried, or no, I was not worried. Simply that I don't know. Long story short, option 3 and 4 are going to be missing in our data set. But for this specific case of Bangladesh, for the pilot in Bangladesh, I didn't find any missing value, any I don't know or I don't want to answer in our variables. So, I mean, there are no issues for the pilot survey in Bangladesh. Okay, moving ahead, the second step, once we have our data set recodified according to the standard label and according to the 8 items, we need to estimate the severity of food insecurity, which is associated with each household of the order of the holding. This is done by running a probabilistic model. Now, the probabilistic model basically estimate some coefficient, which are the beta I parameters and the theta H parameter, which are gonna be used in a standard template, which I'm gonna show in a second, to estimate the probability to be either moderate food insecure or severe food insecure. The idea behind this model is that all else being equal, more severe items or more severe experiences will be reported by fewer respondents. And just to give you an example about this, we can imagine that if we ask about being worried to not have enough money to eat, let's say in the United States of America, we will get very few people within our large sample, which will say, yes, I'm worried about not having enough money for purchasing enough food. This implies that in the United States, that item is gonna have a very high severity of food insecurity. But if we ask the very same question to, let's say, a rural areas of a given country, let's say country A, whatever country it is, in a rural area, perhaps, given the economic condition, et cetera, many respondents will say, yes, I'm worried that perhaps in the coming days or in the last 12 months, I didn't have enough money to purchase enough food. But this is a more widespread situation among many more respondents that reside in the rural area of country A. Now, the severity of food insecurity in the rural area related to that specific item, which is being worried, is going to be much lower compared to the USA. This is a more widespread situation, and people will know how to get food even if they don't have enough money. But in the USA, where perhaps the economic conditions are a little bit better compared to rural area. Having a few respondents that are worried implies that the severity of food insecure is much higher compared to the rural area. And that's the logic behind this probabilistic model, which is the RASC model. Now, when we run the model, we basically estimate two parameters, I would say, overall. The first parameters are gonna be estimated and associated to each item so that we can categorize items from, let's say, the less severe to the most severe. If you look at this table here, this one, you will see that all the items that are associated with the eighth fierce question have a corresponding parameter. In this case, being worried as is the least severe parameter, whereas the most severe is to skip a meal for an entire day. So world day as the most severe food insecurity experience. And you will see that the increasing severity depend on where the item is and the associated parameter. So I would say that run out of food, being hungry, and skipping food for an entire day are the most severe parameter. Whereas being worried or do not eat nutritious food are the least severe parameters related to the item. The second parameter that we need to estimate is related to the raw score. Now, the raw score simply is the number of affirmative responses given by a person related to the eighth fierce question. Therefore, the raw score is a categorical variable going from 0 to 8. So we have potentially 9 values from 0 to 8. The idea behind the raw score is that if a respondent, the raw score of a given respondent is 4, this would imply that that respondent is more food insecure than another respondent with a raw score of 2. However, the raw score tells nothing about the difference in the food security severity between the two respondents. We only know that the first respondent who has a raw score of 4 is more food insecure, but the distance between the first and the second respondent, with the latter having a raw score of 2, in terms of the food security severity, we still don't know. And in order to know, we need to estimate the parameter associated to the item. Now, once we have done it, and this is, let's say, the key of this indicator, the FIES team within FAO has developed this template. The template basically is used to fill in the estimated parameter and to derive the probability to be moderate or severe food insecure. So what we are gonna do, once we have estimated the RASC model and therefore the parameters, is to simply copy paste the associated parameter in the FIES template. And then gonna show you the way this is done. Now, if I go to the FIES template, which is here it is. Okay, imagine that you have a template which is completely empty. So you know you don't have it. So this is completely empty. But we have estimated. Okay, let me try. I don't know if you can see if I work like this. Okay, we have estimated the item parameters. These item parameters for each item are gonna be copy-paste here. So what I do is to copy-paste the parameters. Therefore, for example, being worried as a parameter of minus 3.44, and I'm gonna report this here. And the same applies to all other parameters. We still have to add the coefficient associated to the raw score. You see here that we have 9 value overall from 0 to 8. And for this 9 value, we will have the what is called in technical term, the ability parameters. What we need to do is to copy paste the ability parameter in this table here. You see, like if you have a raw score of 0, the ability parameter is minus 5. If you have a raw score of 1, is minus 3.6. And indeed, this is reflected from the estimation of the RASC model, and so on and so forth. And you go ahead. We also have to copy paste the standard error. And finally, which is basically, you know, the error, the average error that you do while running a regression analysis. And finally, we need to report the number of cases. The number of cases is simply the number of respondents that report a given raw score. In this case, we have 292 agricultural holding or household of the holder of the holding having a raw score of 0. 57% they have a raw score of 1, and so on and so forth. 34 they have a raw score of 2. And if you look at the, the final number, we will get, let me zoom in, we will get 420 cases, which are exactly the number of sampled agricultural holding. Now, once we have done it, we will automatically get in this table, this is perhaps the most important table, I'm gonna highlight in yellow, we are gonna get both the percentage of individual having a given raw score. So we know that 70% of the overall sample has a raw score of 0, 13.6% has a raw score of 1, and so on and so forth. But what we get, and this is the most important, is that are two probabilities. The probability to be moderate food insecure, given the corresponding raw score, and the probability to be severe food insecure, given the corresponding raw score. If you look at this probability, you will notice that the higher the raw score, the higher the probability to be moderate or severe food insecure. And the same applies to the probability to experience a very high degree of food insecurity situation. The way we have, the technical person behind the SDG indicator have decided to use this information to characterize the sustainability status of the agricultural holding is pretty straightforward, and it's effective, I would say, because we are going to use this probability, and depending on the probability and on the raw score reported by each agricultural holding, we're gonna say that the sustainability status of the area associated with the agricultural holding is desirable, which corresponds to a mild food insecurity status of the household, of the holder of the holding. If the probability of being food insecure moderate food insecure is less than 0.5, and the probability to be severe food insecure is less than 0.5. In case the probability to be moderate food insecure is greater than 0.5, but the probability to be severe food insecure is less than 0.5, then the sustainability status is going to be acceptable. Finally, if the probability of the household of the order of the holding to be severe food insecure is greater than 0.5, most likely corresponding to a very high raw score, then the sustainability status is red, which correspond to a severe food insecurity situation. Now I'm gonna show you the way this is practically constructed, this indicator, using, okay, this is indicator number 10, and I'm going step by step. So the first thing that I do, I hope you can see my screen, but I'm gonna zoom in. The first thing that I'm gonna do is to, okay, again, to upload the information that I need, in which case I'm only gonna keep the 8 fierce questions that are needed in order to estimate the parameters. And what I'm gonna do is to recode. Now, we said before that if the answer is yes to a given question, then the code is 2, and 1 if the answer is 0. And then I'm gonna do this recode. The data set will look like this one, and this is still a raw data set. And now I'm gonna add the standard label to our data set. What I'm gonna do is to rename each variable, raw variable, with the item name. And I'm gonna add the label to the corresponding answers given to each label. So the data set has been reshaped or has been recodified a little bit, and you will see that you have the agricultural holding unique identification number and the number of affirmative responses and negative responses for each food insecurity item. And these are 8 food insecurity items. Moving ahead, what I need to do is to generate the raw score. The raw score is simply the sum of the affirmative answer to the 8 fierce questions. In this case, you see that there are 4 affirmative answers for the first agricultural holding, to worried healthy few food, and finally 8 less. So if we sum up, we get 4, and so on and so forth. The second has no affirmative answer. Now I need to run the RASH task, this probabilistic model, to get our estimated parameters. Okay, this is gonna take some time, but basically what we get, meanwhile this is running, what we get is this table here with all the coefficients associated to each item, and this table here with the ability parameters associated to each raw score. Okay, these are, and if you look at this graph, you see that the number of affirmative response to the item word day, which implies I felt worried to skip a meal for a word day, is very low. This implies that this is the most severe food insecurity experience of a given household. You have very few respondents who said yes to this item, and a much larger number of respondents who said yes to being worried. Now, if I'm gonna reduce a little bit, perhaps I can put it, this is worried. The first bar chart that you see here is worried. The latest, the last is skipped a meal for an entire day. Okay, once we have run our model, I need to close it. Okay, we have our parameter that for ease of reference, you have copy paste in the Stata script. You see, these are all the parameters estimated related to each item. And then I also have the raw score, so the ability parameter associated to each raw score. What I have to do now is to take this parameter and to copy in my in the FES template exactly here. We need to copy paste it, this one here and this one here, including the standard error and the number of cases in order to get the probability. Once we have our probability from the RASC model, what we are gonna do is to generate a variable, which two variables actually. One variable where which captures the probability for each raw score to get, let's say, a moderate food insecurity experience, food insecurity status. And another variable which capture for each raw score the probability to have a severe food insecurity status. In this case, this probability have been taken from this table here, simply. So what I did was to copy and paste the estimated probability in two variables. For example, if I have a raw score of zero, my probability to be moderate food insecure is zero, and the probability of experiencing a severe food insecurity status is zero. However, if I have a raw score of seven, the probability to experience a moderate food insecurity status is almost one, and the probability to estimate a severe food insecurity status is greater than 0.5. So once I calculate these two variables, I can simply derive the sustainability status of each household by doing, constructing a final variable, which is equal to one, meaning desirable. One stands for desirable. If the probability to have a moderate food insecurity status is lower than 0.5, and at the same time, the probability to have a severe food insecurity status is less than 0.5. If the probability to have a moderate food insecurity status is greater than 0.5, but the probability to have a severe food insecurity status is less than 0.5, then my sustainability status is acceptable, which corresponds to moderate food insecurity. Finally, if the probability to experience a severe food insecurity status is greater than 0.5, the sustainability status is not sustainable. If I calculate this variable, and I'm gonna look more closely at my data set, you will see that in this case, okay, let's keep it short, but in this case, the first agricultural holding has a raw score of four, corresponding to a probability to experience a moderate food insecurity status, which is 91% given the item, whereas the probability to experience a severe food insecurity status is a bit more than 0%. In this case, this is acceptable because the estimated probability is greater than 0.5 for moderate food insecurity, but lower than 0.5 for severe food insecurity. In this case, if I take this household number three, this agricultural holding number three, I will have a probability to be moderate food insecure, which is 0.1%, and the probability to be severe food insecure, which is zero, which correspond to a desirable sustainability status of the agricultural holding. Last case, you see here, he has a raw score of eight, therefore the probability to have a severe and moderate food insecurity status is one, 100%. That's why the sustainability status is red or not sustainable. Again, I'm gonna save my data set, which I'm gonna use in a second. And I move to the final indicator. The final indicator, which is about secure tenure rights to land. Now, this sub-indicator basically captures the proportion of agricultural area according to the sustainability status, which is defined as desirable if the agricultural, the holder of the agricultural holding has a formal document with the name of the holder or of the holding on the document, or has the right to sell or has the right to bequeath any of the parcel of the holding. The sustainability status is acceptable if the agricultural holding or the holder has a formal document, even if the name of the holder is not on it, in case of no positive responses to any of the four questions, then the sustainability status is red, not sustainable. Okay, we need, a few information from the survey module. The first one is the information about having or not a formal document and whether there is the name of the holder or of the holding on the document. Then we need to see whether the holder has the right to sell or to bequeath any parcel of the holding. These are the four information that we need, and therefore we need to construct four dummy variables. The first dummy variable is equal to one if the holder has a formal document, zero otherwise. The second is equal to one if there is the name of the holder on the legally recognized document, and two more variables which are equal to one if the holder or the holding has the right to sell or to bequeath any parcel of the land. Okay, I'm going to show you the calculation of this final indicator, which is very straightforward. If we decide to use the survey module, basically what I'm gonna do is to first generate a variable to know whether or not the holding has or the holder has a formal document. So if it has it, and this is captured by question C11081, the value is one and zero otherwise. Then I'm gonna construct, let's say, a specular variable in case there is no, they have the document, but there is not the name of the holder or of the holding on that document. So the first variable capture holding having a legally recognized document with the name of the holder or the holding. The second dummy variable instead capture those having a formal document, but not the name on that document. Then I'm gonna construct whether the holder has the right to sell and whether the holder has the right to bequeath any parcel of the land. I'm gonna construct this variable. And finally, I'm gonna generate this final indicator. You see here I added a short description, and they say the sustainability status is green in cases there is a formal document with the name of the holder on it. The sustainability status is still green if they have the right to sell any parcel of the land, or if they have the right to bequeath any parcel of the land. Finally, the sustainability status is acceptable in case the agricultural holding has a formal document, but there is no name on it. In all other cases, no positive responses, then the sustainability status is gonna be red or unsustainable. So this is the typical data set where you see here the first agricultural holding is desirable because actually this holding does not have any formal document, but he has with the name on it, but the holding has a formal document with no name on it, but he has the right to bequeath any parcel of the land. Acceptable, which is holding number two, because the holding has no right to sell or bequeath, but he has a formal document, even if there is no name on the legally recognized document. Let's take this one, which is red or non-sustainable, because as you can see, there is no formal document, neither with the name nor with no name on it. The holding has no right to sell any parcel, and the holding has no right to bequeath any parcel of the land. So I'm gonna save again the last data set, and I'm gonna close everything. And Stefania, I don't know, there would be the last few slides to show about reporting on SDG if I can, but I don't want to.
No, of course, of course. It seems we don't have any question on these last two sub-indicators.
Yeah, the very last, let's say, part of this exercise is about constructing the final data set and about the modality of reporting on SDG 2.4.1. Now, what we have to do is basically, now that we have all the sub-indicator calculated, we need to construct a couple of final data sets at the national level. The first data set that we construct basically report for each sub-indicator the value in hectare of the agricultural area under a given status. So the data set will look like...
Can you increase the size of the slide?
Yeah, sure, I'm sorry.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'm sorry. So basically, as you can see here, we have the sustainability status, and then we have for under each sustainability status and under each sub-indicator, these are 11 sub-indicators, linked to the three dimension, we have the corresponding area which is desirable, acceptable, and non-sustainable in hectares. This is expressed in hectares. I want to very much highlight that these are in hectares. And indeed, if you look at the total area, this should, of course, these are unweighted statistics because we don't have the weights. But this area will correspond to the total area, agricultural area in the countries. And we know for each sub-indicator, the value, the total value of the area, which is desirable, acceptable, and unsustainable. In reality, the SDG indicator 2.4.1 talk about the proportion of agricultural area. So what we have to do simply is to calculate the share of the total agricultural area, which is desirable, acceptable, and non-sustainable for the sub-indicator that we have. In the case of the farm output value per hectare, we will immediately notice that of the overall total agricultural area in the country, nearly 11% is desirable with regard to the first sub-indicator. 18% is acceptable, and 17% is non-sustainable. Now, this data set in reality is really mirrors the logic behind the SDG indicator 2.4.1. What we have done here is simply to add up for each sub-indicator, the total agricultural area of those agricultural holding having a desirable sustainability status, the total agricultural area of agricultural holding having an acceptable sustainability status, and finally, the total agricultural area of all holdings in the country having a non-sustainable status. So this is really the final indicator. I'm gonna show you how to construct it, and finally we'll go to reporting on SDG 2.4.1 before closing this session. Okay, here we are. You may recall that before we constructed 11 data set, which we are now gonna merge all together. So you will notice that we still have a data set which is at the agricultural holding level. So the reporting unit is still the agricultural holding. For each agricultural holding, we have the total, the corresponding agricultural area, which is this variable here. And then for each indicator, sub-indicator, we have the sustainability status. Now, what we have to do now is to know for each sub-indicator, what is the proportion that is sustainable, desirable, acceptable, and non-sustainable. So what I'm gonna do is to simply generate 11 variables which correspond to the total agricultural area of the holding. And I'm gonna merge these 11 variables in such a way that I can then calculate the sum under each indicator by sustainability status. I'm gonna show you how to do it. This is very much a standardized script, so you can apply it. If all the other indicators, sub-indicators have been properly calculated, you can simply run it. And of course, better to double check, but you can simply run it. Okay. If you look now at this indicator, perhaps I want to go back before what I have done it. Let me show you, for example, for one indicator, just for one indicator. I have, you see here, okay, let's forget about the other 10 indicators and let's focus on the first sub-indicator. Now we see here that we have for this agricultural holding, the hectares, the corresponding hectares of the agricultural area and the sustainability status. What I'm gonna do now is to simply sum at the national level all the hectares of agricultural area which are acceptable, desirable, and non-sustainable. So if I sum it, I will get that 55 hectares are desirable because I have add up all the agricultural areas of all agricultural holding with a desirable status. 93 hectares are acceptable and 360 hectares are not sustainable. And I'm gonna repeat this exercise for each sub-indicator in order to get something which is basically this one. This one is for each sub-indicator, the hectares that are under a given sustainability status. So, and finally, what I need to do, of course, is to also calculate the share. I need to calculate the share. The share can be simply calculated by constructing a variable which is equal to the total area in the country, and then by dividing, I need to go back again, and then by dividing the total, so imagine here that we are gonna construct the total, which is gonna be equal for each sub-indicator, and then we're gonna divide the agricultural area, which is desirable for the first sub-indicator, by the total agricultural area in the country. A better way to see it is perhaps to an Excel file, because the Excel file will give us let's say a more flexible way to calculate this indicator. And I'm gonna show you the Excel file, which is this one. This is the Excel file that I have derived. So let me zoom in. Here we have the dimension. Here we have the most important, let's say, breakdown, which is the sustainability status. Here we have the dimension. For each dimension, we have the corresponding sub-indicator. For each sub-indicator, we have the corresponding area which is non-sustainable, acceptable, and desirable. And if you see at the total area, which is at the national level, this is constant across all indicator or sub-indicator. The last thing that we have to do is to know what's the share for this sub-indicator, which is sustainable, acceptable, and desirable. In order to do it, we simply divide. What we divide is the total area which is not sustainable by the total area in the country. And we get, for this first sub-indicator, 70% which is not sustainable, 18% which is sustainable, and finally 11% which is desirable. If we sum the three share, we will get 100% for each indicator. We're gonna get 100%. So if we sum 70 plus 18 plus 11, we are gonna get 100%. But this is irrelevant in reality. Okay, now about the reporting. So another way to see is according to the dashboard approach. So the dashboard approach will look like this one, and you will immediately get a general overview of the sub-indicator and the corresponding agricultural area which are more critical, for which policy action should be ideally be implemented, and so on and so forth. But in reality, what we want to know is that the larger proportion of the agricultural area which is unsustainable. In order to do this, we have this formula where SDG underscore 2.4.1 index D stands for the proportion of agricultural land area that has achieved the desirable level. And then we have the SI indexes D and N, which is the proportion of some indicator N that is classified as desirable. And finally, the minimum that goes from 1 to 11, where 1 to 11 stands for the 11 sub-indicator, which refer to the minimum level of the desirable level of the desirable status at the national level across all 11 sub-indicators. And indeed, for the case of Bangladesh, and using the data from the pilot survey carried out in Bangladesh, it is pretty straightforward to see that the sub-indicator with the highest level of unsustainability is farm output value, with almost 71% of the total agricultural area that is classified as being unsustainable.
Gianluigi, can you go back to the previous slide?
Sure. This one.
Yeah, this one. So actually, there is a slight, error in the formula that you have shown here. So the final proportion of agriculture area under productive and sustainable agriculture would be SD underscore 2.4.1 A plus D. So okay, it will yes. be the area acceptable plus desirable, and then you would say minimum N1 minus up to 11 SD. A plus DN.
Yeah, you're right. I'm sorry. I'm gonna correct it immediately, and I'm also gonna tell you that you can easily find the right formula under the SDG 2.4.1 web page here, which is this one. Let me show you for the sake of clarity. Here it is, and thank you, Asfandiar, for correcting. And here it is.
Yes.
This is. These are the two formulas that are used to.
So if the country wants to track only the green area, then they will use the first formula, which is SDG 2.4.1D, which is, you know, the best possible scenario whereby the country is doing great in terms of its sustainability in agriculture, and everything is green, so they may want to use the first formula. If they just want to track the progress as to whether their agriculture is sustainable in general terms, then you know the second formula, which is D plus A, okay? That one should be used, or on the flip side, they can use the third one, which is SDG 2.4.1U, which is 1 minus SDG 241 D plus A. Or it is, on the flip side, maximum unsustainable across the 11 sub-indicators, or maximum red reported across the 11 sub-indicators.
Yeah, thank you very much for clarifying it. It was very late yesterday, so it's, I'm sorry again. Okay, from my side, I hope I was able to give you an overview of the overall process of the SDG 2.4.1. And I don't know how Stefania and Asfandia want to proceed.
Yes, so I don't see any question for this. I imagine, Gianluigi, you will not come tomorrow, right? You will not join us.
No, I'll be joining, absolutely.
Okay.
Happy to join, absolutely.
Okay, but anyway, just for the information of our colleagues, so the practical aspect that Gianluigi showed in these 2 days have finished. So tomorrow I will be presenting my presentation, because today is already late. It was planned for today, but we will move to tomorrow morning, which is the FAO data collection questionnaire, and then we will leave the floor to you. So in case you have any question for Gianluigi. So he said that we'll join also tomorrow, so you can also ask tomorrow, or in case now you still have a couple of minutes. No, I don't see any raised hand. So I think it's one sharp here, so it's five p.m. in your country.
Discuss it again, because in yesterday we have discussed that on Friday, that is tomorrow, we will start the session half an hour.
Exactly. Yeah, I was going to say this. So tomorrow we will start at 2:30 p.m. your time to allow the pray time, of course. So we will join. We will start half an hour later. Let's see then during the course of the day tomorrow if maybe we need to make a shorter break, or it depends on the discussion. So we will see tomorrow in the course of the training. I think we can close officially, and really thank you to Gianluigi for all these 2 days, for having presented this calculation on data. And so see you tomorrow at 2:30 p.m. Bangladesh time for the last day. Bye-bye.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.